famous last words, things that people say on their deathbed. Some are funny and light and frivolous. Some are extremely wise and insightful, profound and prophetic. I want to share with you some famous last words of Jesus at or shortly close to his death, and use this words to celebrate the life and the resurrection of Sylvia, and to bring you promise and comfort in your life as you live on with her in your heart and your memory. Close to the end of his life, in a small group of disciples, he said these words, "Love as I have loved you." When you think about this admonition from Jesus to love, he didn't say it in such a way that was to be bland or everyday type of love. It was a love that was to be possessed, a love that was to be on fire and impassioned, a love that was not just middle ground, but a love that went all the way. He said, that's how you'll know, and they will know that you are one of my disciples if you have this type of love. Visiting with the family, I've learned of a lady who had an impassioned, passionate love. A mother and a grandmother who loved and adored, supported all the way her children, Vic, Tony, Dinah. And with the same type of love and passion, gave herself to her grandchildren, Harrison and Libby. You said she had that type of love through a marriage. For a young man she met in 1948, it was described as love at first sight. They were married within just a very few weeks of the very first time she and I met. Today, as we celebrate her life and resurrection, we celebrate this type of love and a reunion of Ike and Sylvia. And perhaps they're somewhere in heaven right now listening to Floyd Kramer and spinning some old 33s on the hi-fi listening to brother Dave Gardner. But for you, those of you who don't know who that is, that's just because you're not old enough. But those are some incredible talents that are no longer here today. Not only did she have an impassioned love for her children and her grandchildren, an impassioned love for her husband. But you know, she had an impassioned love for God, and this is some of the ways they expressed it. It was a love for God's world, a love for God's animals. Little critters, as they're described, her cats, Sandy and Tiger. She had a love for the human animal as well. It was expressed by a passion for justice, expressed in causes and politics and letters, an activist, a person who approached her love for God and her approach to a love for the human animal. So much so, she is affectionately referred to as the Dragon Lady, who takes no prisoners. You see, she loved God because she loved God's marvelous, wonderful creation. You think about it, living is a mysterious experience. There's so much to know, so much to learn, and this is a lady that I have learned had an insatiable appetite for knowledge. She read and read and read everything from auto repair manuals to the great literary masters. This lady was a lover. As Christ said, love, that's how they'll know you are my disciples. A lover of Christ's church, a member of First United Methodist Church here in town, where she served during the 70s as a bookkeeper. Yes, love as I have loved you. But there's a second expression, a famous last words of Jesus. I know that you are familiar with this, to the thief on the cross, where he said, "Today, you will be with me in paradise." A parallel story of that, "Today you will be with me in paradise," is a story of Lazarus. You may know of this story. Jesus had a good buddy whose name was Lazarus, and he was very ill, but Jesus was out of town. Word got to Jesus. They said, you need to come. But Jesus took his time, as the scripture described it to us. He didn't get there, and Lazarus died. If you'll read the story, Lazarus's sister, Martha, met him on the edge of town and actually gave him a little bit of scolding and said, if you would have been here, Lazarus wouldn't have died. Jesus said, Lazarus is sleeping. Martha said, no, he's dead. Jesus said, no, he's sleeping. No, dead, sleeping. And Jesus uttered these famous words, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even when he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Martha took him to the tomb. And he said these words, in my imagination, must have sounded like James Earl Jones when he said, Lazarus, come forth. Today, I want to proclaim the word of God, the truth of that scripture for us and for Sylvia. You see, on this side, Sylvia is sleeping. But on heaven's side, she has heard the words, Sudi, come forth. For the scripture says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Sudi spent her life in an attempt to make this life a paradise, to be a lover. But today she has entered her peace into her paradise. And finally, the third famous last expression of Jesus that we'll use today to celebrate the life of this loved one are these words. Do this in remembrance of me. Of course, Jesus is using those words to institute what we call communion in the Last Supper. But he had given them many things to remember him by. And in fact, he said, when I go away, I will send my spirit who will bring to remembrance all that I said and all that I did. It is a very strange experience that I cannot understand from the death of my loved ones, but when someone passes that we love, there is a spirit that comes that brings to remembrance all that they said and all that they did. And that memory will live forever. The words that I speak, the obituary that you read, the pictures that you view on the screen, and your own memories will bring to remembrance so many things that Sylvia will come again and visit you just when you need her. Here are some things that are memories that will be etched in your heart forever. Vic, you'll always remember, perhaps you inherited the part of her that was called Dragon Lady because she was a fighter and a protector. I don't think it's any mistake that you spent your career in the military as a fighter for rights, for peace, for your country and your family. And in your enlistment and in your service, she was so proud. And I know that there's nothing that inspires more than a mother's pride in a child. And Tony, you'll carry with you perhaps the part of your mother who was curious, who had to know, who had this insatiable desire to know more about the world in which she lived. And you share a special bond with her in the reading of books. One I have been told is, tell me that you love me, Judy Moon. And Dinah, it's probably no mistake that you became a lawyer because she was an impassioned person for justice, in politics, in fighting those things that are wrong, to protect the innocent. And Dinah, it's no surprise that that's what you do today. And you know, you'll always remember that time in your life where you made a career change. And it was your mom who encouraged you, who said, you can do it. and I will help. It is my privilege to meet a young lady today, except for one letter has the same name of my daughter. Her name is Livia, and she carries a special place, and she gave you a nickname, Lee. We don't know why, but what other name could there be than what Grandma named you? It doesn't have to make sense. It's just your name. And won't you always remember the time that you became famous because she came to school and didn't know that the rules applied to her, that the traffic cones meant do not park here? And at the time, I'm wondering if that embarrassed you. And your grandmother became famous because she was the only one who stepped out of the car who moved those cones and said, this is my spot. You'll carry that for the rest of your life to know that your grandmother is always there. And it doesn't matter if you're at the grocery store and you're not getting service the way you ought to be getting it. In your heart, you're going to hear these words, get me the manager. Take charge type of person, wasn't she? And for all of you, Harrison, Liv, Vic, Tony, Dinah, for all of you who knew her, I want to tell you something from her to you. Listen carefully. You can do anything you want to do. And don't let anything or anybody get in your way. Have I represented this loved one correctly today? As I listened to her, I said, you know what? I have my problems too. I'm a preacher. I'm a pastor. But we all have them. And I said, I wrote these words and I said, thank you, Sylvia. Because I need somebody to move those cones in my life. I have those restrictions. I have those obstacles. I have those people that are telling me, no, you can't go there. You can't do that. And this lady says, well, just move the cones. You can do that. It's not that complicated, Al. Isn't that a wonderful, wonderful memory to have in your heart for as long as you live? Who knows when you'll need it? She also gave to you, Liv, the love for God's creation and his critters and his animals. And I don't know this, I'm only just guessing. I bet you she gave you and the other grandchildren, Harrison, a wonderful memory of your grandpa, Ike. And the only thing you know is what she's told you in the pictures she showed you. And I'll just bet you, from what I know, she can almost represent Ike as good as he could if he was here himself, because she's that much of a lover, and she's just got to tell you about Grandpa. There are special friends, friends by choice. I don't know what that means. I think they were adopted into the family. But it is special to be adopted into a family. If you go online, you can read her obituary along with the picture in the Star Telegram. And there are in the message board there is these words from Jim and Judy Mitchell. They're here this morning. I wanted to read them to you. This is online. I will truly miss my instant reference person, Sylvia. You possess so much knowledge that you reminded me of the role Katharine Hepburn played. By the way, if you're not old enough to know who Katharine Hepburn was, you're just not old enough, but it's still all in black and white, where she played in the movie Desk Set. Thank you for always being just a telephone call away. You had so much love to give, and you dispensed bunches of it on all the little critters that entered into your world. Also, I've always remembered when I was a teenager, seeing you sitting at the kitchen table with coffee and writing your congressman about something you felt passionate about. No wonder Jim Wright had to retire. After reading all your letters, he was wore out. I will miss you big time. Love, Judy and Jim. Bring to remembrance all that she said and did. As I think about her and I have visited with your family, I think about the words of Henry David Thoreau. He said, if a man does not keep pace with his companions, perhaps it's because he's heard the beat of a different drummer. Let him keep step to the music he hears, however measured or far away. The lady I have come to know was a red-headed, hot-blooded lady of Irish descent who was an impassioned mix of convictions and contradictions. But when those convictions and contradictions came out, were expressed with incredible wit and always with wisdom. Here are my personal applications from this lady. See if they might be applications for your life as well. Fill your heart with love. Be impassioned for those things that really mean something to you. Number two, fill your head with knowledge. Be curious about God's world. And number three, make sure it's right and then go ahead. Take action. Make sure your life really, really means something. Thoreau wrote in his journal, I moved to the woods because I wished to live deliberately, to front only the essential facts of life so that at the end of my life I did not discover that I had not truly lived. Listen to the words of a simple poem and think about her life. My candle burns at both ends. It will not last the night. But all my foes and my friends, it gives a lovely light. Sylvia Sue Hilliard. Truly lived. Amen. The music you're going to hear now is Forever and Ever, Amen. Because as we celebrate her life and resurrection, we rejoice with her that she is now in the arms of her true love, Ike. The words, music, lyrics of the song express that now.